Thank you in Jesus' name.
There's only one who overcame. Oh, Lord, So easy sometimes to come into this place and to be disconnected. But Lord, you are so kind and you are so gracious and you are so merciful that it doesn't matter where we have been this week or the thoughts that have been in our minds this week, Lord, your presence still comes. When we humble ourselves and we cry out to you, Lord, you come and you meet us where we are. Lord, you are a mighty God. You are a powerful God. You are omniscient. You are wonderful. You are magnificent. And you still come and you desire to engage with us and you desire to meet with us. And Lord, we don't ever want to take that for granted. We don't ever want to take your presence, God, in this time that we have to enter in, Lord, for granted, and that's something common that we do. But Lord, let our hearts be full of gratitude and thankfulness that we would remember, oh God, that you have come, that you have saved us. Lord, that you turned our lives around. God, that you promised that you would never leave us or forsake us. Worship you from that place of gratitude. Come on, let's sing one more time. Can take your seats. As you do, just give a smile to the person next to you. If you don't know them, say hello, say hey, my name is, what your name is. But we are so happy to have you here this morning. Yeah? Sorry, I'll take this out. Okay, yeah. It's so good to see everyone this morning. You know, it's so funny. Mum walked in. That's my mum, if anyone doesn't know. Mum walked in. She's like, where are the people? I'm like, there's some over there. And then all of a sudden we turn around and all your beautiful faces are here. And my heart was full of joy. So it's so good to see everyone today. And I'm so glad that you can make it. I really believe that you are here for a reason and a purpose. And I really believe that God has a Rhema, God-breathed word for your life this morning. Yes, our God doesn't do things by accident. He doesn't do things, you know, that just fall into place just because. But he's very intentional. Amen. And he's very purposeful with his word. So if your heart is open and your mind is ready and your spirit is ready to receive, I believe God's going to speak to you this morning. Amen. Tell the person next to you, are you ready to hear what God has to say? Tell them, ask him, are you ready to hear what God has to say? Maybe they're not ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Okay, good.
All right. Good morning, church. Oh, we're going to have to do a little bit better than that. Good morning, church.
Hey, or as Pastor John says, is it, oh Lord, it's morning. That's a good one.
Now, I'm sure he's watching on the stream right now. So I welcome everyone who's watching online here this morning as well. So we say a very big good morning to those online. We welcome you here. And we want to welcome everyone that's actually come here face to face. It's really nice to see all your lovely faces here this morning on Sunday morning.
Yep.
It's the holiday season.
Unfortunately, some of us have gone back to work already.
Yeah, I know some of us have gone back to work.
Some of us never stopped working.
Some of us are still clocked off. Lucky them.
And then you've got the kids at home.
Yeah. So we just want to just share some really quick things. As you know, right now this is the quiet time or the quiet season of the church at the moment. So life groups are not yet back on, and you know, the prayer on Wednesdays is not yet back on, but we do want to just continue to encourage you guys to come here on a Sunday morning. Youth is not on at the moment either, but there will be some details coming out in the weeks to come when youth is about to start. So please keep an ear out, keep an eye out, make sure you're tuned into the socials as well. So a lot of the communications, the comms come from the social platforms. So just keep an ear out, keep an eye out. Amen?
That's a very corporate.
It is, that's why I was like.
Sorry, I don't know, I don't work in corporate.
All right, so we wanna just continue this time of worship. We wanna give you an opportunity to give. I know a lot of us give online, and the details will be coming up on the screen. How many know God is good?
Yeah, amen.
All the time, amen? Yeah. So we want to give with an open and cheerful heart, and we just, you know, want to provide this opportunity to give back. Amen?
Amen.
All right, so let's pray. Lord God, we come to you this morning and we thank you, Father. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to gather as people, to gather as church, or God, as family members, Lord, to praise and to worship and to lift your name and to invite you into this place, Lord God. And we ask right now, Lord, as we prepare our hearts to give, Lord, that we would give open-handedly, open-heartedly, oh God, that we would give cheerfully, oh God. And Lord, that we pray that 2024 will be a year of blessing, Lord God, that would be a year of prosperity, oh God. Lord, a year of financial blessings, Lord, in this year, Father. We speak, Lord, life, and we speak joy, and we speak peace, Lord, in every member here, everybody listening online, oh God. We pray that you would meet every need, Lord, that they may have, oh God. You know their situation, and you know their circumstance, oh God. And Lord, we pray and we honor you, God, because you are faithful, oh God. And we may stray, Lord God. We may go up and down and straight to the left and the right, but Lord, you are constant, oh God. You are always, and you always will be, Lord God. And we thank you, God, and we honor you right now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right.
Amen. So if you guys have your offering, or you know, if you've given online, that's okay. We invite you up, and then as we do that, the kids, there's something on for you in the kids class, so you guys can head there, head that way. And babe, I'm going to give you the honors
That's all right.
of introducing our guest speaker.
So some of us, you know, some of us know, like I said, this is the holiday season. Our pastors are away at the moment.
And we bless them.
We do.
And we hope they have a good time. And we pray for their protection and their rest. You know, they give so much of themselves to this church, and we are so blessed to have them. And we love them and we honor them and we are for them resting. How many of you guys know rest is important?
That's right. Amen.
Rest is very important. But they've left us in very, very capable hands.
That's it. And with that, we have an absolutely amazing opportunity to hear not only from Pastor Wendy, but also my cousin.
So Wendy, come.
So we
want
to welcome Wendy. Round of applause, guys.
Ali.
Yeah.
So we're going to... Some of you might not know Wendy. Most of you probably do, but Wendy... actually came out of this house.
Yeah.
She was one of the daughters here.
And then
God sent a man her way, and he just came and he was like, man, we're going to plant a church and we're going to do this. And she was like, yes, and she was all for it. So you know what? Go, Wendy. Go, Wendy. You know, when you say yes to the man, you say yes to his calling, right? That's right. And so Wendy and Ray pastor the Reaching the Nations Church in Liverpool, and they have so graciously lent us to her so she could bring our word for today. So we're going to pray for her.
Yeah.
We're going to bless her.
Bless her.
Yep. We're going to ask the Lord and the words of his word to speak to us. Amen. Amen.
Amen. All right, let's pray. Lord God, we thank you right now for Wendy. We thank you for this earthen vessel right now. Lord, I pray that you would use her right now. We pray that your spirit would come and flow and speak through her. Lord God, that I pray that these words that we hear this morning will be challenging, Lord God, that we will challenge us to be better people, Lord God, to draw closer to you, to draw deeper with you and closer and nearer to you, Lord God. Lord, I pray that these words that will go forth here would land on good ground, oh God, that our hearts be ready, oh God, that our hearts be prepared, Lord God, that you would strengthen Wendy, Lord, through this time, Lord, in these moments that we have, Lord God, for your word to be shared. Lord, we ask that you would just speak to her and use her in this time. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, let's make her feel welcome.
All right.
Amen. Well, thank you so much for having me and welcoming me. As they said, yes, I am a daughter of the house, and I have many mothers in this house as well. There's one of them there. it's a blessing to be here, and I don't normally preach even at my church, you know. And I guess, you know, we all have our thing or our calling or what it is that, you know, that God has called us to do. And sometimes we say, well, I'm not a preacher. I'm not, you know, a worship leader. I'm just not a leader. I just want to be that person that comes to church, sits down, tries to remember what they preached about on a Sunday, put it into practice to the best of my ability, and then come back the next Sunday and do it all over again, right? But God has different paths and different things that he wants from us. So I was speaking to Christiana outside. I don't know where she is right now. There she is. And she was telling me how she had to host Christmas this year. And if that is your task, I sometimes feel that even when it's not my turn to host Christmas for my family, it always kind of ends up being my task as well. You know, someone has to send out the invitations. Someone has to decide what food we're going to eat. And if you're like me, I do like things to look nice. So what color scheme am I going to use? Do I want to use last year's decorations or not? You know, is my budget going to be enough? What I've told them that they got to pay me, you know, because I can't afford to pay for everybody to come and eat. So I make them give me money so that we can all contribute. But it all ends up on, you know, on someone's responsibility. You know, and this year, I also, it so landed that we, you know, the 24th was a Saturday, which is, you know, the, when Latinos celebrate. And then the 23rd was the Friday. And so we decided to have our service early, our Christmas service early. And we also had a dinner, and I also had to prepare for that. So I was completely frantic. And what I always normally do at Christmas time is always take the week upcoming for Christmas, I take it off, because otherwise my stress levels rise higher than what they need to. So I just decide to take it off. And it's not a week off, if you know what I mean. It's just a week of like, oh, what else did I forget to order kind of week. And anyway, after all that hard work, this year we almost missed out on some family members coming because of COVID. You know, that dreaded COVID always comes to mess things up. And I was like, Lord, why? Why is it that, you know, it's just this time of the year that we mainly get to possibly come together and have everybody come. And, you know, why now? Why now? And today I'd like to speak to you about interruptions. And interruptions will always happen. They come, and they come unexpectedly, and we have a choice that we can make. We can either get angry. I get angry. I get upset. I question within myself. Even this year, when I was planning my own birthday, I got a little bit upset. And my cousin saw me, a different light of me, because things weren't going right. And I couldn't find, you know, the runner that I wanted to put on the tables. And, you know, that's just me. To you, perhaps that might seem like something silly, but to me it's a big deal, because I went out and I bought it and I planned for it. And I wanted everybody to feel comfortable in my house and to have a good time. But interruptions happen. So we have a choice that we can make. We can either get upset, or we can either run with it, right? And to interrupt, the meaning of interrupt means to come into between, to break into, to break in upon a person, to stop or hinder by breaking in, to break the uniformity of continuity of whatever it is. Proverbs 16:9 says, in their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord establishes their steps. Now, we're at the beginning of the year, and, you know, one thing that my mum was always very pedantic about was, we need to pray before the year comes in. Because there's something, I believe there's something spiritual that happens when that year turns. There's something new coming in the spiritual realm. And let me tell you that as God prepares for something good to happen, the enemy is also planning to be your stumble stone along the way. So it's so important to set our ways before God. And I believe if we are able to set our ways before God, the Bible says that He will guide our path. And if we learn to do that early on, then we might have less interruptions in life. Right? Because God has come to die for us for what? What does it say? What does the Bible say? He came to die so that no one will perish, but so that we will have eternal life and an abundant life. That was God's purpose on this earth. So if our attention is not on God, He's going to come and He's going to interrupt what you're doing. And even if we think it is, He might still come and interrupt what you think you're doing right. As you know, Teresa spoke a little bit about you know, how I was the daughter of the house, and yet, yes, I met my husband, and I went to another church at the time. Something happened at that church, and it so happened that we had to leave, and there was a time of mourning because of what we had experienced. And during that time of mourning, people wanted to get together. And, you know, actually when I was going out with Ray, we used to pray together. And one day he said to me, he goes, "We're going to get married." I said, "Yep." And he said to me, "I still don't know what my calling is." She said, "You, when you marry the man, you marry the calling." And he said to me, "I don't promise you a house. I don't promise you where we're going to live. Because if he tells me that I have to go somewhere, I'm telling you I'm going to go. So you marry me knowing that, that's my basically my only condition." And growing up in this house, you know, as pastors, you go through things. That's just a normal part of ministry. And that's whether you're a pastor or any other type of leader or whatever it might be. And I always said, I never want to be a pastor ever in my life. Those were my words. I had seen how the pastors at times had gone through trials, because pastors do go through trials. Pastors get hurt by people in the congregation. It happens, because as pastors, we pour out our heart and our soul into people. It's not into the building, it's into people's lives. And sometimes we feel betrayed. Sometimes we feel hurt. Sometimes we hear people complaining because the water wasn't cold enough, or, you know, that's just a silly one that I'm giving you. But we hear other things, and it's like, really? That's what you're complaining about? You know, and when we left, you know, there was a time with these people that we were gathering with, and they went into a month of prayer and fasting. And I remember we were in a little community hall, and there was a vote done. They said, "Okay, we wanted to start a church." So the vote was done, and they voted for Ray. It was the worst day of my life. I grabbed Ray. I literally grabbed Ray. I took him outside, and I said, "You're not taking that." I did. I pulled him outside. I said, "You're not taking that." He goes, "Yes, I am." And so, you know, that's how my journey began, with me reprimanding my husband to not take what God had ordained. And, you know, 20 plus years on, here I am. God comes and he brings interruptions to our life. We have a choice. We either embrace it or we don't. And can I tell you, I mean, those first years were hard. I had my dad, it was just my dad playing the guitar and I had to sing. And my dad didn't know how to adjust the chords to bring them down to my definitely not soprano voice. So he would leave me hanging on notes, on keys, and it would drive me insane. They were like the first, you know, years of ministry that, you know, that I had. So, and that was difficult for me. That was frustrating for me. But I guess it also gave me patience, or at least God was trying to teach me patience. But, you know, God comes and he will get our attention no matter what, because he has a purpose and a plan for us to be able to do the will that he has called us to do. Now, we just celebrated Christmas, and I was thinking about Mary. You know, according to some of the stuff I was looking up, she was like a teenager when that angel came and said to her, "You're pregnant." Devastating for some it may have been, you know, as a teenager, as a young child, one could say, because I still see teenagers as children. You know, I have one of my own, so I still treat him as a child sometimes, and he reminds me that he's no longer one. But Yes, so I can imagine how she must have felt. Now, the Word of God doesn't tell us how she felt. It only tells us that she obeyed or that she took on the task. And I think worse for Joseph. I mean, who's going to believe that story? Right? But, you know, they must have been planning their wedding, planning their lives together, but they made a choice to bring up the Son of God. And they also, through bringing up that child of God, they also suffered. They suffered, you know, seeing him die and at times possibly being rejected. It doesn't say that his parents followed him along, but I think as a parent, I reckon I would have wanted to see where he was, what he was doing, making sure he was okay, because that's what us mothers do. And, you know, she was Jewish, and, you know, Jewish people are the same as Latinos and every other wog mum that's out there. We want to make sure that our children are taken care of. Moses is one of my favorite ones. I love the story of Moses, and I love watching the old school Ten Commandments movie. I like that one. And, you know, Moses had his life interrupted because of people's prayers. People were crying out for somebody to come and deliver them, for somebody to come and get them out of slavery. So sometimes God isn't going to come and interrupt your life, not necessarily for you to have a benefit for yourself. We've got to remember that, because it's not about us. It's about God's greater plan. So imagine, this is how his life started. He was born, and he was born into a time where they wanted to kill the first, any male child. And he was taken from his mother because she had to let him go. Then he's given back to her. Then he's taken away again, sent into a palace. And I guess as a young boy, perhaps he did enjoy the riches of the palace. Because, I mean, if you're like me, a foodie, you like to eat well. I reckon they ate well in those times. Hey, especially if you were living in the palace, you got the best of the best. Right? So he was enjoying the riches of the palace, but there must have been something brewing within him, knowing that he kind of didn't really belong there. That wasn't really his place. And so then we hear the story about him killing an Egyptian because there was something in him that he saw, I guess, the injustice of somebody being punished the way that the Jews were treated at the time. Then he goes to Midian. And just when he thought everything was okay, he hears the voice from the burning bush. Right? Moses, and he's curious. He's curious. And he goes up to see what's going on. But you know what comes into him first? The why me syndrome. Why me? Why can't it be the other person? Right, and we've heard this so many times in so many preachings, but it's something that continues to happen and to hinder us from doing what God is calling us to do, the why me syndrome. But the phrase, do not be afraid, appears in the Bible 365 times. This is because God knows that we're prone to fear. We're prone to worry. We're prone to wonder what's going to happen next, especially those of us who are planners. We want to know what's going to happen next. We want to make sure that everything's going to be okay. And our faith in God should already tell us that. God has already been tested, I guess you could say. He's already been tested. There is nobody in the Bible that, you know, there's no one in the Bible that says, I regret following the Lord. It doesn't say, and Paul regretted following Christ. And Moses regretted, you know, hearing the voice of God. And Abraham decided to turn back because it didn't work out. We don't hear any of that in the Word of God. We only hear how God takes them forward. In all of the adversary that might come before us, He is with us. So do not fear. Do not fear. Deuteronomy 31:6 says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of them, for the Lord your God goes with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you." Now, there is so many beautiful promises such as this one in the Bible. But when God gave Joshua this promise, he was actually about to go out to do the will of God. It was a word of encouragement because he had already said yes. So if you want to be able to experience those promises of God, we need to say yes first. We need to say yes first. And that's not knowing where it's going to take us. You know, Moses was given the staff of a shepherd to show King Pharaoh the power of God. When God calls us for something great, there will come an interruption. And when Moses went to Midian, he probably thought that he was starting to live with a bit of stability. He had married Sephora and they had a son together, but God decided to come and shake him up. Just like some of us, we think that we're going to go through life. And, you know, growing up, I used to have conversations with Letitia, Margot's daughter, who's my best friend. And she was like, I was like, you know what? I'm going to go to uni, finish my studies. And I said, the first thing I'm going to do is buy myself an apartment because I'm going to be really independent. And then we would both dream about having a 3-massive-story house that you see in Vaucluse. And we would go sometimes, I don't know, Michael and Morris used to take us down to this place. I wouldn't be able to tell you. But they could obviously drive at that time and we couldn't, and they were gracious enough to take their little sisters along the ride. And they would take us to these houses and like we could see these beautiful houses, and that's what I would dream about. But God. I didn't even finish my degree, but that's got nothing to do with God. That's just got to do with my lack of planning and discipline. But this may be us. So we're walking about in life, minding our own business, like I said. We attend church most Sundays. We pay our tithes, and every now and again we put our hand up to volunteer for something. And on those days we feel really proud of ourselves because you volunteered, you know. But God says, "I want more from you." Many of us are walking around with a lack of urgency. And like God has put us on this earth to make it pretty. And let me tell you, each and every one of you were handsome and pretty, otherwise you wouldn't be here, because God makes perfect things, perfect humans. And, you know, the Bible does not say that Jesus came to die so that you could have a big house, so that you could have a nice car, or for you to have an easy life. It says that he came to die so that all who believe in him shall not perish but have eternal life. So don't get me wrong. I work in the corporate world, in a financial institution. So I do like nice things, right? And, you know, my husband would tell you that at times I shop too much, but I always say I just shop when things are on sale, so we're still getting, value for money. But, you know, if any of those things are stopping us from following our calling, let me tell you that there's an interruption that's coming your way. When I first started working at the bank that I work for, it's going to be in March, it's going to be 18 years. And I remember I went to my interview and I was shaking in my boots, as one does. And the first day, once, you know, we went through it, and the first day I was so excited, and, you know, they come around and they tell you, so what do you want to do almost like when you grow up? What do you want to do? What's your career progression looking like, you know, on our first day? And I was like, I want to be a team leader. That's what I want to do. And to my dismay, at the time, I didn't know it, but I was placed, the first time around, I was placed with a really good leader. He was such a nice guy. He would come in every day and he would say hello to everyone. He knew who we all were. At Christmas time, he would handwrite Christmas cards to everyone, and he would buy gifts from his own pocket. And I was like, wow, you know, this guy is so nice. And it was easy to work for someone like him because, you know, he really made you feel valued as an employee. And then he left. And then I got put somewhere else. And that's kind of like when my nightmare began, at least, you know, what I thought at the time. And the person that I had, you know, I was working towards becoming that team leader that I had proclaimed that I was going to be, and I was given opportunities. But one day, this lady took me downstairs, and she said to me, "Wendy, we've just been using you up until now because we didn't have anyone else." She broke my spirit. She broke my confidence. She broke everything within me. And I thought to myself, I'm never going to be able to move or do anything, you know, in this place ever again. And I started in my desperation because I thought, with this lady, I'm never going to be able to move anywhere else. So in my desperation, I started applying for other jobs to try and get out. And I tried to go to a branch, and that didn't work out, and I'm so glad. And then I tried to become a facilitator as well, and that didn't work out, and other things. But during that time, those few years, because I guess I'm telling you the story now, but this went on for about 4 years. And during that time, Ray had gone to AIFC because Pastor Johnny had actually told him about it, and he did his counseling studies there. And the leader or the director of that college, I can't remember his name, but he's now resting with the Lord, he was taking teams to Uganda, to Africa, to preach about family issues, because although Uganda is known to be a nation that's Christian, there were a lot of things, I guess, within their culture that still, I guess at times, like in all of our cultures, need a bit of Christianity to come in to make some changes. Anyway, so Ray, the first year he went by himself. Dylan was like 3 weeks old when Ray first went, and then when Dylan was about 3, Ray was like, oh, you know, maybe you should come. And I was like, I didn't want to leave Dylan, but at the same time I wanted to travel because I've always wanted to travel. So anyway, I went, and, you know, had I been in a different position at the bank at the time, you know, when I look back, I wouldn't have been able to travel. And I was able to go to Uganda 3 or 4 times. I can't remember if it was 3 or 4 now. But I was able to visit Uganda, and I was able to preach, and I was able to experience things and bless people and also have a blessing for myself, because when you get to visit one of those countries, you actually get, the Lord speaks to you a lot more at every single corner that you go to. But we were also able to see and, you know, continue to stretch what this man had already started, what he had established and what God had done through him, and be able to take teams over and talk about family principles in a Christian way for those people. And we saw where this man had initially gone to preach. We saw men washing clothes outside and helping their wives. A Ugandan man that would be beneath them. But when God comes and tells us that we're here to serve, and we first serve at home, and we all serve one another, all of that comes down. All of those barriers come down. And that was, you know, something amazing. So God had to come and interrupt my career progression to be able to make me see those things. Did God provide for me during that time? Yes, He did. Did I lack? No, I didn't. Because sometimes we think, oh, I lack because I don't have my wants. That's not lacking. If you have what you need, if you've got clothing, if you've got shoes, if you've got food, if you've got a house, and you don't have to worry about what you're going to feed your kids tomorrow, you're rich. Your needs are being met by God. Sometimes we complain and we think that we lack because we don't have our wants. Right? And that's not what God's about. God is about meeting our needs. And it's not about, you know, our career progression. So yes, He comes and He interrupts. And can I tell you, once I did get this job that I'm in, and I thank God for it as well, because it's given me so much flexibility as well in my leave and so many other things, I am truly blessed. When I finally got this job, I didn't even have to go to an interview. Because that's the way that God does things. And He might make you wait 3 or 4 years, but the door will open when He needs it to be open, when it's not going to be a hindrance to your calling, when it's not going to stop you from coming to church. Let me tell you, I've seen so many people go out and get jobs because they need to pay bills. God is not silly. He knows you've got to pay bills. He knows you've got a mortgage. He knows that the electricity has gone up. He knows that our government isn't doing much about the cost of living. He knows that. But we don't rely on the government, right? So please, if you ever get offered a job that's going to stop you from coming to church on a Sunday, it is not from God. And you need to reject it straight away. Straight away. We've had to do it, or Ray's had to do it, you know, before. We used to go out and feed the homeless early on in our ministry, and we would go on a Thursday night. He was working in retail at the time. As you know, our retail day is 9 to 9 on a Thursday. And initially they had said yes. And then when they wanted to make him go up in his, you know, from what he was doing, his boss came up to him and said, if you want it, then you're going to have to work Thursday nights. So he resigned, and that was the end of it. And we need to be able to do that, because if God has given you a task, the enemy is going to want to come with a better, supposed, better offer. And it's going to look nice, and it's going to look shiny. And you might think, oh, you know, I'll be able to tithe more. God doesn't want your money. He's given you what He's established for you, and you pay what, you know, what you've got. He doesn't need the extra $50 or $200 that you might get. What He needs is you aligned to purpose. Amen. In Matthew 19, verse 16 to 30, we see the story of the young man, a rich young man. Before society, he looked like he was right on the money. He had money, obviously. And he must have been someone who went to the synagogue all the time. And he probably paid to the synagogue what he had to do. And he probably gave to the poor, because that was part of it too. But when God, when He met Jesus, and Jesus said to him, go and sell everything that you have and come and follow me. It saddens me that in that last, like, where it explains how he left, it said that he walked away sad. He went away sad. He was sad because he was going to have to give up. To me, it's control. I think everything that has to do with money is control. Why? Because if I earn enough, right, I don't have to depend on anyone else. I don't have to depend on the government. I don't have to depend on anyone. I go to my work, I earn my money, and I just depend on me. I can afford to pay my house. I can afford to have my car. I can afford to do whatever I need to. So to me, money is a heart issue and something that that really is a good thing to question whether or not my trust is in God. You know, I learnt to tithe here at this church. And I remember when I first started working, oh gosh, back in the day, I worked in Jackie E, which is now Jack, no, I worked in Jacqueline E, which is now Jackie E. And I used to do my 3 hours on a Thursday night. And back in the dark ages, I got paid about $5.30 an hour. So I was coming to church on a Sunday with $1.50. But you know what? It's easy to tie the $1.50. Because when you start earning more money, and you have to start tithing $500, $1,000, I don't know how much you earn, then you just do it. Right? But this young man wasn't able to do that. And the Word of God, you know, because I've heard some preachings where people try and say, you know what? God was only asking him for that money because he was going to give him more. I don't know if God was going to give him more. That's the truth. I don't know if God was going to give him more, but it was the whole obedience thing. What I do know is that he was going to be okay because he was going to be under the will of God. That I can tell you for sure, right? But, you know, we need to see any shakeup that God brings to our lives as an opportunity. And although I've called my sermon interruptions, I was kind of umming and ahhing about it because interruption has a negative connotation. But when God comes to interrupt, it just simply means that our attention is not on him. And that we need to turn to him. You know, let us not be like Jonah. Jonah's funny. He's a funny character. And if you haven't read the book of Jonah, it's only got 4 chapters. And those 4 chapters, I think 2 of them only have like 10 verses in it. It's very short. But he's funny, you know, because God comes and he says, Jonah, go and preach to Nineveh and tell them, you know, that they're going to, you know, die in a couple of days, you know. And Jonah, what does he do? It says, but Jonah ran away from the Lord and headed to Tarshish. He ran away from the Lord. Like, I mean, really? He ran away from the Lord. I'm thinking to myself, at the moment, right, we can't even run away from AI, right, because they're watching us everywhere. And God bless Jonah. He thought that he could run away from God and not be found. He was so reluctant to not obey. So how are you running away from God at the moment? How are you running away? And it might not be, like, if God is telling Jonah to go and preach and tell these people to repent, it's not because he was a bad bloke. I don't reckon God's going to necessarily send somebody who's bad to go out and preach and, you know, send a message. You know, they're good people. Like you and me, they're good people. But I don't know. I don't know what happened to Jonah. But he ran away. So how are you running away? How are you hiding? You know, when they ask for volunteers for something, Are you the one, you know, it's like when the teacher asks a question and you think, if I don't make eye contact, they're not going to pick me? You know, we're kind of like that with God. And like I said before, we're living as if there's no urgency. Let me tell you that the Lord is coming back. The Lord is coming back really soon. We see so much stuff. And you know what? Through the Word, they've been announcing the coming of the Lord since then. So how much more urgency should we have now? Now that we're seeing things that we never thought that we would see. And yet we run away and we just want to come to our church and feel comfortable and, you know, just live life and, you know, and just enjoy my family, enjoy my house, you know, maybe take a holiday at least, which is fine, of course, to take a holiday. I'm taking mine in February, you know, and just to do those things. But God wants more from us. God wants you to be, you know, and it's not to come out and, you know, start a church necessarily or to come up here and preach next Sunday, but it could just be that you need to be speaking to a friend and telling them about the love of God. And maybe stop judging them because you've already spoken to them five times and they've said no to you five times. Because that was Jonah's attitude. And what saddens me is at the end of the story, you know, we all know he was there, you know, God came and interrupted him running away, and he himself, look at this. This is what does my head in a little bit, is that when the storm was there, it wasn't the people on board that said, let's throw him out. He volunteered. He said, throw me out. So it was like he was willing to die rather than go and preach. Right? Like, why? Why would we do that? And like, we're the same sometimes. Right, he was just willing to be thrown into the ocean. Oh, no, it's me. I know it's me. And out I go. I take accountability. But why not have the conversation that he ended up having when he was in that fish those 3 days? Why not have it before? Right? And that's all that God wants. One of the things that every single person he has in common is that when God brought an interruption, it was also an opportunity to hear from God. Sometimes we think, oh no, God doesn't speak to me. He doesn't speak to me. I don't know what he wants from my life. You know? But maybe we just haven't had the time to stop or slow down from what we're doing for him to come and have a chat. You know what? And at the end of the day, I think deep down, we all know what God wants from us. There's a voice inside that tells you, it's like that same voice that tells me to stick to my diet, right? But I'm like, I just want a little bit of cake. I just want a little bit of sugar, you know? And I know that the sugar's bad for me, right? But we still want it. But we all have that voice. We all know what God wants. All of us know exactly what God wants. And if you need a bit more help with that, I can tell you in this house, there are people that are more than willing to help you find it. There are people in this house that are willing to stand with you in prayer and fasting to find out what God's will is for you. And the best thing to do is to try, and if that one doesn't work out, then you try again. That's just how it is, and that's what you need to continue to do. But at the end of the story, Jonah's attitude was one of indifference to the task that was at hand. And he felt that the people of Nineveh were not worthy of God's mercy. Sometimes when we don't want to preach to our friends, we might be saying the same thing about them. And you might think, oh no. But yeah, it is, if we're not willing to open up our mouths and tell them that there is a God that loves them and a God that is coming back. The enemy knows, and he's coming with us with distractions. Our phones are sometimes a distraction to not having time to read, to not having time to study. our work, as I mentioned before, even our me time, I'm not saying it's not good. In fact, this afternoon, I plan to go and get a massage because I go back to work tomorrow. So it's good. But whatever comes in the way of you and God needs to stop. Right? Matthew 6:33 says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." And I can tell you that God will not be like that drive-through person that says, "Do you want fries with that?" Your fries will automatically appear with your order because God knows that you want them or whatever it is. The add-ons just come without us knowing, and they come even bigger than what you expect them to be most of the time. Because my God is not a small God. And you might be going through a struggle at the moment that has come to interrupt your life. And it may come to us in the form of a sickness, in the form of job loss, in the form of fear. Whatever it is that God wants, whatever it is, God wants you to be walking in freedom within your struggle. Which brings me to Paul. I love Paul. We've been talking about Paul a lot in church lately. And he was a man who was 100% rooted in Christ. Did you know that the letters of Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon were all written while he was in prison? And yet, they deal with some of the most liberating concepts imaginable to us. You know, in Ephesians, while he's in jail, he's speaking to us about the armor of God, about how to battle. Right? Sometimes we will be in prison because God hasn't promised us an easy life. He's promised us just to be with us and to hold our hand through it. He didn't stop Daniel going into the lion's den, but he did close the lion's mouths. He didn't stop those three young men from going into the fire, but he kept them from being burnt. Right? So he doesn't tell us that nothing wrong will happen. But could you imagine if Paul had decided to be like Jonah and said, "Lord, I was serving you, I was preaching, and now I'm here. What am I going to do from in here?" You know, nowadays we watch movies and we see people in that are in jail, and they, you know, they get given a phone and they start texting from there or whatever. But he didn't have that. But he used what he had, a pen and a paper or whatever it was that he was writing on. Because his task, he knew his task was to make sure that those churches stayed alive, that the name of Christ was still going to continue no matter what was going to happen to him. There was an urgency within him and a passion for the Christ that he had once persecuted. So to a human way of thinking, every story has a legitimate reason why we should classify God as rude sometimes for coming to interrupt, that we would have the right to walk away from him. But remember that the enemy brings interruptions and distractions to keep us from our purpose. Look around and see what is happening in your life that has become an excuse to make you have a foot in the church and one outside. Jesus was constantly interrupted, wasn't he? He was trying to get somewhere, he was trying to do something, and there would be kids coming at him, there would be people that wanted to be healed, there were people that just wanted maybe some counsel, but each time we see that God shows mercy, he shows a willingness to be compassionate, a willingness to listen, a willingness to heal, and a willingness to set free. So God is trying to get your attention. What he wants you to do this morning is to figure out who's currently got it or what's currently got your attention. I want you to close your eyes there where you are. And as this year has started, we have an opportunity to be able to say, Lord, I lay my ways before you. Guide each of my steps. Some of you might have big decisions to make this year. It could be around your career. It could be around your work. It could be around your business. It could be around your family. It could be even around perhaps where you're living at the moment. The Lord wants you to give it to Him. Every decision that you have to make, give it to the Lord. He's knocking at each of our doors, and He's looking for a willing heart that's willing to be opened. At times we've been preached to Christianity about benefits. And yes, it does have benefit. But if we're only here for the benefit, then we're in the wrong place. You're in the wrong religion. You're following the wrong God. His purpose was for you and me to have a relationship established with Almighty God, to be able to recognize that Jesus Christ is the one who came to die for us, for our sins, to give us redemption, to set us free, so that we might also go out and do the same thing. And if we choose to follow Him, He says the Son of Man doesn't have a pillow to rest His head, but He promises a presence that will never leave you, that will never forsake you. That when you're walking through the valley, He'll be your light. That when you're walking through the storm, He'll be that lifesaver. Sometimes we worry about following God because of what we're going to miss out on. Let's not be like the rich man this morning and walk away sad because we can't do what He's asking us to do, to be more committed, to be more passionate, to be asking, what else can I do for you, Lord, with my time, with my resources, whatever it is. I know that God is always wanting more, but that's because He wants to give us more, more of His presence, more of His promises to come to life. So I want us to pray. Let's stand. Father, we've heard your word this morning. Father, and we're glad that you are a God who wants our attention. Father, you come to us with loving hands, oh Lord God. Father, you come to us with loving words. Father, and it's not because you want what is bad, Father, for our lives, but because you have good thoughts for us. You have good plans for us. Father, and this morning we pray that as we're still in the beginning of this 2024, that you will establish our steps. Father, that we might put our lives around you and your will and your purpose. Father, and as we concentrate on you, oh Lord God, Father, we know that we will receive what we need. Father, I pray that this morning that you will bring about clarity of calling, that you will bring about, oh Lord God, clarity, oh Lord, in decision making, that you will put peace in people's hearts. Father, and that those who need help will come out and get it. Father, for we don't walk alone. That's why we come to church, to be accountable to somebody else, to have somebody to stand with us in prayer, to be able to stand with us in the times that we need to be corrected. Father, I pray over every person in this place, every young person. I pray that each of us might be able to put our plans before you, Lord. Father, for you know what is better. You know what we need. You know how many lives we can touch. Father, you know that as humans we need purpose. And we know that we can find it in you. Worship the Lord. And if you feel that you need prayer this morning, you can come to the front. Amen. You might need guidance, or maybe you haven't been hearing the word of God or his calling, but he's willing to help you out.
And if you guys, you know, want prayer, you can still come up. If you feel like this word really spoke to you and you're like, yes, God, I want to continue the rest of my year with my life submitted and surrendered to you, to your plans, to your interruptions. If you feel like that's something that you have struggled with and you want to commit your life to God or commit your ways to God, come. Altar is open. We'll still pray for you. We have time. We have time. Goodness of God. Thank you, Wendy. Come on, let's give her a round of applause. I told you it was going to be a good word. Amen. All right. Well, that's it for today. We're so glad you were able to make it. We pray that you have a fantastic week, and we'll see you back next week. God bless you.